So my talk may be a little bit different than the other ones that you hear about in this talk, but I think it's really relevant. So I am playing two roles. You can see under my name. I am the 2016 IEEE Humanitarian Activities Committee member, and I'll describe what I do that a little bit later, and also I'm the past president of the Microwave Theory and Technique Society. So here's the outline of my talk. Motivation, why now, why us? The point I would like to make is the engineers are part of the humanitarian solution. I will describe what is the rapidly changing landscape for space technologies. Describe then what we're doing in terms of future directions, and then describe a concept that we're calling the Internet of Space. And finally, a call to action, building a new technical community. This should be a familiar a chart to all of you. IEEE, this is what we stand for. Our mission is to foster technological innovation and excellence for the benefit of humanity. So in fact, if you look underneath the IEEE logo there, that is our tagline, advancing technology for humanity. So my question to you is, what exactly are we doing to advance technology for humanity? What are you doing? Our vision is to be the global technical community and for technical professionals everywhere, and to be recognized for contributions to technology and our technical professionals improving global conditions. So yes, we are technical people, but we're also human beings. We also are members of the human race. So if you look at here, this chart, which I borrowed from the UN, there are 17 sustainable development goals that the UN has identified. I won't go through all of them here, but the ones that I have starred for the Sustainable Development Goals are with reference to ICT technology, information communication technology, which we are all about. We are the IEEE, we are electrical engineers. We help to come up with solutions that affect these particular goals. So my question to you again, how are you involved to deliver sustainable engineering solutions to meet these goals? Things like quality education, gender equality, decent work and economic growth, industry automation and infrastructure, sustainable communities and megacities and smart cities. These are all things and themes that we are talking about in terms of making life better. So right now, let me play for you a really short video, only the first part, to get you into this framework, asking yourself, what are you doing? What is technology for the benefit of humanity? And the title of my video is called, The World Needs More Resilience. Here I show you a newer version of the Maslow hierarchy of needs in a kind of a humorous form. As you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs helps for us to classify the basic needs of life in terms of water, food, shelter, education. But in this cartoon here, you see that the cartoonist has added the requirement of internet access as being crucial, because now this is something that we can no longer imagine that we can live without in our daily lives. Right? Don't you all agree? So I ask you the question, is internet access a luxury or a necessity? So communication and access to the internet for information needs is now to improve the quality of life is being recognized as a human right. I'm quoting Nicholas Negroponte, the internet access is such a fundamental part of learning that by extension, it is almost certainly a human right, and within a very short time, it will be particularly because of those who don't have schools, those who do have learning on their own. Now, this is one point of view. As you can see by the second bullet, this is not yet fully accepted. The federal FCC member, Michael O'Reilly, says, it is ludicrous to compare internet access to a basic human right. So I think I would tend to agree with the first statement. If you look at the life of a typical day of the internet, this is what we live with. This is what we're used to. Millions and millions of Instagrams, Skype messages, purchases online, YouTube videos, over 200 billion emails are sent a day. This is the world that we live in. This is the world that we expect that our children and our children's children in order to live in. But yet, is this a fair thing? Is it only for us, but is it for the entire world? These are the benefits that we all want to have from accessing internet technology. Business growth, creation of jobs, services, but is the benefit reaching to everybody and everywhere? If you look at this map here, this is the penetration of internet usage as of 2012. As you can see in the dark blue, places like United States, 81%. The highest rate of penetration, Scandinavian countries like Norway, 95%. But then I point you to Africa, 1.5%. So in areas of that, and also parts of Southeast Asia, like India, 13%. So we are not on equal ground. We are not giving the same benefits to the rest of humanity that we claim that as part of a technical community is really part of our responsibility. If you look at some charts I borrowed from the ITU, there are two ways of supplying broadband to the world. In the developed world, fixed or wired, copper wire, coax fiber is supportable because we have highly dense, densely populating centers and we can afford to run the copper. In most of the world, that's never going to happen because of cost barriers. Now, the other one, which I'm going to talk about for the rest of my talk, is how we're going to leverage satellite technology in order to come in from the other side of this chart and provide the last mile access. So the future connectivity is not just about the people. It's really about connecting people and things. I hope that many of you have heard of the term IoT or the Internet of Things. The IoT will be the next economic driver in order to reshape what we believe the internet will be all about. It's just not connecting you to me, but to almost every single object, whether for healthcare, for climate change monitoring, for disaster management, agriculture, and smart cities. All these things will be dramatically changed by the Internet of Things. It is predicted by the year 2020, over 50 billion devices will be connected and grow exponentially. So this is the new world that we're going to be living in within the next 5 years. So it's not just various different institutions like the UN and other people that are seeing that this is happening. So the new trend is actually being identified by a name called new space, or the commercialization of space. In old space, or I would say the legacy space, was primarily governed by policymakers, funded by national governments, in order to fly very few satellites and other sensors into space because it's outrageously expensive. But now there is a brand new explosion of activity. As I cite on this particular chart, 700 of 800 companies are now getting into new space, and none of these were in this business before. So you heard the big ones, which I'll describe to you what they're doing, include the ones like SpaceX, OneWeb, Google, Facebook. These are not traditional aerospace companies, but yet they're going to be the movers and shakers of the next 10 years, just like internet has taken over, just like IoT will take over within 5 years. Space will not be the same once this new ecosystem is developed. Even the popular media news coverage now is calling it the new space race. And what I'll describe to you is now very exciting, and that all of us in this community can be part of it. So to set stage, I just want to tell you that in the old days, primarily satellites were flown up to geostationary orbit. at 22,000 miles, at the satellite rotates at the same rate the Earth is rotating in a 24-hour period, and therefore the satellite looks stationary if you look up at the sky. Now, one problem with that is there's a very long propagation delay because of the distance, somewhere in the range of 500 millisecond to 700 millisecond. So in the old days, when you made phone calls, you heard that delay or echo because of that problem. People, were happy to go over fiber optic now, which you don't have that problem. There are a number of satellites in the medium Earth orbit, things like GPS, things like that right now provide other services. Those do not stay the same location, but they travel across the horizon. So you need a constellation of satellites, around 30 of them, in order to cover the entire globe. But what is revolutionary now that I'm about to describe to you is creating new constellations of satellites down at low Earth orbit. But because the satellites are moving so fast at a lower orbit, you need hundreds, if not thousands, of satellites to provide global coverage. And this is the revolution that I'm describing. So the vision is ubiquitous connectivity from satellites. So we thought that this kind of died because we got fiber optic networks, we got terrestrial networks, cellular networks, but I think it's coming back. It's going to come back in a big way that I think will surprise a lot of you. So how does this connect with the benefit of humanity? And I will make the case here for you. 60% of the world's population is not connected with internet services. But from space, as I can shown here, unfortunately, the globe with all the rotating satellites is a little bit dark to see. But you can see that from this animation that we're going to have a network of thousands of satellites providing internet access anywhere on the globe, on land, on sea, in the desert, wherever you need to be. And once such a network becomes developed, people will be empowered to impact their own lives and through the sharing of ideas, enabling the exchange of information for aid, weather, medicine, education, commerce, and ultimately delivering hope to the underserved people of the world. So microwave satellites can provide the backbone for global internet connectivity. So here's the idea. In my world, instead of calling new space, we're calling it the Internet of Space, IOS. We believe that within 1 to 3 years, that even more so than now, broadband connectivity will be provided to aircraft and ship, which is already happening now as people convert from terrestrial systems into satellite systems, go-go and other places. You're going to see much faster internet access in the airplane. And then to cover the entire globe within 3 to 5 years, and to the planets, to the moon and Mars, probably within 10 to 20 years. So this is the vision which is out there, and I think it will happen. Now, how does that connect to you as a scientist, as engineers, as professionals? Well, I'm going to show to you how the work that you're doing really could impact and become a major contributor for the Internet of Space. It's going to affect aerospace systems, antennas, autonomous systems, communications, electronics, and so forth. Now, what we believe is going to be happening with these satellites, it's going to be instead of minivan or bus-sized satellites, they're going to be toaster size, basically about the size this big, about 100, 150 kilograms, and going to be have to be considerably cheaper. But there are other ways that the Internet of Space is not just for satellites, but it's going to involve using suborbital platforms, such as high altitude, long endurance, or HAL aircrafts, UAVs, and so forth. So we believe that many of these things, once they happen, will serve as a critical backbone to the Internet of Things, and to provide that connectivity to the unreached part of the globe. Now, so what is the challenge? The challenge is shown on this slide. To do what we're saying that needs to be done, before in the geostationary satellites, those satellites cost anywhere between $100 and $500 million per satellite. That's why they need high reliability, high performance, able to survive and live in space in a harsh environment of radiation and so forth for 15 to 20 years. But now we're talking about a whole new generation where we're going to fly probably in the range of 1,000 to 2,000 satellites, and we're going to need 10 to 1,000x improvement in SWAP. SWAP stands for size, weight, and power, and cost. So any of those factors, in order to enable this type of system, we'll have to improve in one or more of those dimensions. We need new innovation in spectrum management, small and microsatellite design, unmanned vehicles, new ground architectures and protocols, millimeter wave and transceivers, antennas and phased arrays, additive manufacturing, microelectronic circuits that are new generations that 10 to 100 times cheaper, handsets, airborne and nautical terminals that will be affordable. And there, of course, I highlight in red, areas of interest in your field of interest, including MEMS, sensors, timing, and synchronization. How do you get 1,000 satellites to be synchronized together and also working with the handset? That is a major challenge. It has to be 100 times cheaper than what you guys are making today. So I'll go over very quickly some examples. Some of you, if you follow the technical news, you will know what's happening, but to show you that this is not just fiction or science fiction, but it is happening. One of the most, well-defined venture is on OneWeb. OneWeb plans to launch more than 600 satellites in LEO Earth orbit. They're at about 750 nautical miles high, with a number of investors between $1.5 and $2 billion, they are going to make this happen. The company that OneWeb has already given a contract to is Airbus. Airbus, as of last week, announced the groundbreaking of a satellite factory in Florida. And you can see from this picture, they intend to create this factory delivering up to 15 satellites per week. That's unheard of. Typically, to build a satellite takes 4 years, $200 to $400 million. So here's the idea. Let's bring the web to the whole world. Here's an example of the toaster-sized satellite delivering to a terminal that's in a school in a remote and rural area. Here's some more examples of what potentially they're going to be doing. I won't go through this. You'll see that the two main ventures that are being funded are in fact funded by two billionaires. OneWeb project is partially funded by Richard Branson. Okay, and you can see a picture of the satellite. You can see a picture of potentially what the terminal looks like. And here's a graph from Airbus showing that what they intend to do. So this is truly going to be a revolution in terms of satellite, nothing like what we've seen before. Of course, the second player I cannot, not mention is SpaceX. I ask you the question, does this inspire you? This inspires me like nothing else does. But of course, this is just a takeoff, right? Okay, the landing one did not start. I don't know why. Landing one was actually even more impressive, landing on the drone, right? You saw that. I had a video of the landing. I mean, I could watch that an hour at this loop playing back. This is representative of new space. This is a commercial private company doing things that NASA used to do, that the European Space Agency used to do. They are going to do it faster, cheaper, better. And so we can be part of this community. So SpaceX, not to be left out, if Elon Musk and SpaceX can land a rocket on a robotic drone, this is just the beginning. They have now formed a satellite office in Seattle. So their constellation is even more aggressive. They want to build 4,000 satellite constellation. If anybody can do it, SpaceX can do it. I mentioned other platforms, non-space. Here's an example. Google has been playing around with weather balloons. So weather balloons, you can deploy very cheaply. So what you can do is you send it above an area where it's needed, let's say after an earthquake or disaster, and that can provide emergency communication very quickly. As the wind blows about, it's not going to be persistent, but it's going to do a job in terms of providing communication. And isn't that what we're all about? Facebook, okay? Who would associate Facebook with this type of technology? That this is the new world of new space. Facebook is designing a UAV drone that will fly and do a persistent orbit, circling around a certain area, providing cellular coverage, providing internet access. So the internet space is what I'm calling all the activity related to communication at low Earth orbit and then near space. This would be near space. So let me turn your attention now to what we are doing within the IEEE. IEEE has a committee called Future Directions. Future Directions is chartered to look for new and emerging technologies that world challenges that IEEE can impact. And we try to match up planning, funding in order to make it happen. So we look across all the different operating units to figure out what is on the next wave and try to capture that and create technical communities. Future Directions has already done a number of different projects, as I've shown you on this next chart. Things like Internet of Things, smart cities, big data. On the bottom, I show you a progression of going through the incubation process of Future Directions. You start off being an incubated project, you go through phase one, and coordinate between different operating units, and then you create a presence, create a technical community, and then position yourself to become a self-standing organization. So here I show you on the left-hand side, this is what we're about to do with the Internet of Space. We are going to go through the incubation process. Through the cooperation of already several different organizational units, we have now first started off as MTT starting an ad hoc committee. I did that last year as president of MTT. We applied to get a seedling approved for the FDC for the Internet of Space, and now we have a formalized MOU with APS Society and EMC Society to form the anchor societies of this new initiative. In this year, we held a workshop at the Radio Wireless Symposium. We're going to hold a rump session in about 2 weeks at the International Microwave Symposium. And then in June, in the June FDC meeting, we'll present to give our proposal to develop a full program starting 2017. So just to show you that this is not just things that other people have done. Last year, Atsushi Sanada, you can see on the upper left-hand corner, a professor in Japan, and I organized a workshop in Japan called Resilient ICT for Disaster Relief in Japan. Just like, not quite as ambitious as the one I showed you from Facebook, but the Japanese, when they went through the tsunami earthquake 4 to 5 years ago, all the communication systems went down. They were a first world country, but they did not have communication. They were in really bad shape. So the NICT, which is a research organization in Japan, and many others in Japan, are looking into this type of technology in order to impact disaster relief. You can see there a drone, a little drone. They were able to put a base station repeater. So demonstrate that within probably half an hour to an hour of a disaster, they can be circling around the whole earthquake site and providing emergency communication. So again, we are creating microwave systems for the benefit of humanity. So this, I'm almost to the end of my talk. This is a rump session that we are organized at the International Microwave Symposium in about 2 weeks. As you can see, organized by our Future Direction Chair, Sanjay Raman, you can see some of the panelists. We are gonna get the thought leaders in this ecosystem to come talk to us, to energize us, to tell us what are the challenges so that our engineering communities can start addressing them. People from OneWeb, a Viasat, a Boeing, Facebook, and so forth, right? So this is really exciting, and this is why I want to introduce this to your society. In the beginning of next year, we'll be launching a first topical workshop on the Internet of Things, Internet of Space, and we now are accepting papers, and so hopefully this will be a launch of our activities for the technical community. So this is my last slide. Empower every person and organization on the planet to achieve more. This is what we're really trying to do. So so if you look at this slide, this is a slide that I used throughout last year as president to saying that MTT, our technology is inside all those different products, all the way from low frequency down, such as RFID, RFIC tags, Zigbee, Bluetooth, and then eventually through the different, the higher frequencies up to 70, 80 gigahertz. And you can see the Internet of Space there. This is what we're trying to create. So during last year, we were able to get APS and EMC to join in this effort, to be part of that technical community, to create the technology in order to make the system possible. So this is my last slide. I would like to see UFFC as part of this community. and to be part of our initiative. So my question to you is, will you join us? Thank you.